Our next presenter, Lucia Patrizio-Gani, is presenting on the title of Levantines and the British Consular Service. She's from University College London.
Paper couldn't have been a better introduction to mine. So when I read my paper, just remember what Despina told you about the merchants and their status and their wealth and their connections in the Levant. So George Wheeler, in his renowned volume A Journey into Greece by George Wheeler Less in company of Dr. Spoons of Lyon, celebrated for the views of the Parthenon before its despoliation by Elgin, described the British factors who lived entirely, become rich, and get great estates in a short time. He noted that the consuls were greatly respected, had the best reputation amongst the English consuls, this is the French consular delegation, and the custom house, and the board was taken by the Turkish authorities instead of searching vessels. In 1813, the British traveller John Oliver Hanson noted in his note that amongst the European powers represented in the Levant, the British were the most considerable in point of wealth, respectability and power, and their consul the most feared and looked up to. Many of them spoke English language and were married to women of the country. Showing great hospitality and generosity toward the travelers. Successive members of the Levant Company served as consuls through the years, as Despina and the previous paper told us. They established themselves in the Levant and set up family. Their diplomatic representation combined with their trade, and they counted on the support of the company to maintain a high standard of living and to work efficiently. Indeed, they were financially supported by consulages, fees charged by the Levant Company on imports and exports. However, as a result of the liberalization of trade in the 19th century, the privileges of trade given to the company in the 16th century were slowly eroded away. These are the consulates of the Levant Company. The ideas of free trade theorists like Adam Smith advocated that the exclusivity granted to this chartered company was restricted to free trade and universal wealth and needed to be abolished. Therefore, in 1825, after years of sharp decline in profit and following the acquisition of the Protectorate of the Ionian Island in 1815, the company was invited to surrender its charter. Since it was no longer connected with the protection of public interests, its privilege could be interpreted by the public and parliament as damaging restriction to trade. So, the Protectorate of the Ionian Islands in particular had created a specific and complicated duty to look after the Ionian citizens wherever they traveled or resided within the territory of the Ottoman Empire, because the Ionians were now seen as Franks or foreign subjects by the Ottoman Empire and were not subjects to the laws of the Empire. Sadly, therefore, from being merchants looking after a community of merchants to protect their interests, the consuls found themselves having to deal with political, criminal, and religious issues within their wider community. And because of this, when the Foreign Office took over, established a much larger network of consulates. France, Austria, and Russia had started to use their own consular offices for political gains, and it was felt that the British consular service in the Ottoman Empire needed to be focused on political goals as well, and to observe and counteract the activities of the other powers of the port. The Foreign Office took over in 1825 with the initial intention to absorb the diplomatic and consular services and to reform its personnel in its entirety. It was envisaged that the appointment of fully British-born personnel would revolutionize and clean up the service and make it more efficient. But there was little understanding of the exact requirement of this service at this point, of its financial costs, of the practical requirement, or of the fact that different places have different customs and that an understanding of this was essential for the proceeding of the diplomatic posting. The changeover to the Foreign Office, therefore, was not as smooth as it had been expected. Economic priorities in London clashed with the financial and local requirement of the service. The consulages fees were abolished by the Foreign Office, and thus a major source of revenue came to an end. This decision affected the income and quality of life offered to the consuls and failed to consider the consequences of a badly remunerated representation on its personnel. Furthermore, the Foreign Office did not reconfirm the employment of the dragoman and clerics. The role of dragoman in particular had often been passed from father to son with the trust that existed between the company and its employees, which had formed an essential part of their relationship. The decision to leave them out, to leave all these officials without work, unable to care for the families and with no means of support, affected their behavior and their loyalty, and damaged the reputation of the British in the area. For those officials who were lucky enough to be retained within the company, within the Levant service, or for those who were newly appointed, a meagre salary would be the only compensation to a diplomatic life. Spina talked to us about Francis Perry. He was consul in the Levant for over 43 years. At his consulate in Smyrna, the reorganization had created chaos. By eliminating most of his staff, Perry had been left at an old age, he was 83 at this stage, with an enormous burden of work. His son, Nathaniel, who was vice consul, wrote to the Foreign Office. I wish simply to call to your attention that there is, independent of the vice consul duty, considerable business in the Cancelleria, that an English and an Italian, Greek and French clerk, both which receive a salary of about 120 per annum, beside another clerk, are constantly occupied, and that they were paid out of the fees of office, which were generally sufficient under the old tariff. By Act of Parliament, these fees would be much reduced, in fact they were removed altogether. I consequently beg your kindness in regulating this particular to observe that in giving me additional duty to perform, adequate remuneration may be granted to me, and at all events, that in lieu of promotion being granted to my long and urgent solicitations, my boss might not be rendered more onerous than it was before the Levant Company consulates were transferred to the Crown. There is considerable unavoidable expense attending the representation of the cost, and that though economy is the order of the day, Mr. Cannon would, I'm sure, wish appearances to be not maintained in the proper manner, neither extravagantly, but certainly not shabby. By reorganizing the districts, scrapping interpreters and clerks, and failing to provide accommodation for his consuls, the Foreign Office created a profession that was lonely, badly remunerated, and gave little opportunity of personal satisfaction and career. Appointment under the Levant Company had been by vote of the factors, but this was no longer the case under the Foreign Office administration. The Levant Company system of selection in the restricted circle of the factories had allowed its members to put forward and support friends and relatives for appointment in the consular service. Despina told us as well that generation after generation of dragmen and consuls became diplomatic representatives for the Levant Company, with members of consular families working in different parts of the same geographic alliance. And amongst these, Wilkinsons, Bigliocchi and Perry are just some of the names that were recurring in the Aegean. These appointments had assured a smooth and efficient continuation of the Levant service throughout the tenure of the Levant Company. However, it was precisely on this typology of personnel that the Foreign Office and the press chose to focus their attention for a number of years. In England, in fact, public opinion was directed by the press, which strongly resented the concession of a state monopoly to a private company and the employment of its personnel in the diplomatic conduct of state affairs. Thus, rather than focusing on the newly created organization, the Foreign Office, that allowed a change of circumstances in the Levant service, the press chose to attack one particularly vulnerable aspect of it, the employment of the Levantines. Defined as men of English descent, domiciled sometimes over several generations in the Levant, the Levantines were a particular figure of the service in the Ottoman Empire. A later description in the parliamentary papers extended the definition to include those consuls sent directly from England, but who had been employed in the Levant for many years. Levantines understood local traditions, could speak the language, and had a precise understanding of what was expected from a foreign diplomat in the Ottoman Empire. For this reason, their employment had been a natural solution under the Levant Company, but it appeared to pose difficulties at Foreign Office level. It was not until 1858, 33 years after the transfer to the Foreign Office, that a select committee on the consular service inquired in Parliament about the nature and quality of personnel employed in the Levant. There still had a problem with them. The consensus was that the British Consular Service lacked a consular code. In the absence of a set of specific instructions, the consuls had to rely on his own common sense and on public opinion in the community in which he resided. The nature of the personnel inherited from the Leyland Company was at this stage a specific preoccupation. The committee appears to have been fueled by the press and guided by articles predominantly in the Times, which in parallel with the happenings in Parliament attacked the Leyland Times employed in the service. Have not the results of the peculiar mode of conducting our commercial establishment in the Levant been that the consulates have a good deal fallen into the hands of families established in those countries and familiar with the customs and usage of those countries? They were asking in Parliament. This inquiry was a specific response to the following piece appeared in the Times, which said, was a very long article, but part of it said, the third most frequent and most obnoxious way of recruiting British consuls in the Levant is from a set of half-English, half-Levantine families who might be said to have acquired a kind of hereditary right to consulships. They are supposed to be Englishmen, although they have perhaps never been in England, and they are supposed to know the country, although they have perhaps never been beyond the place where they were born. They are connected by interest and almost always by family ties with the country where they ought to represent English interest alone. They are, in many instances, very respectable men, but they have too many local interests not to be suspected of bias in favour of them. They remain for a long number of years in the same place and get, as it were, identified with it, losing their character as Englishmen. If we want to reform this and raise the whole body, infusion of fresh English blood and English ideas is required. The 1858 committee compared British consuls to their French counterparts, who were always appointed directly from France and were thus less orientalized and more respected. So it was said, if the consular agent be a Levantine or be mixed up very much with the natives, he certainly does not command that respect from the Turkish authorities which the representative of a great power like Great Britain ought to command. Again, the Times put its foot in it and questioned the honesty of the consuls. The dishonesty which is commonly charged against the Levant consuls has, of course, its excuses. The English standard of commercial and political morality is not applied to an Eastern consul, but our government ought to take care to have it applied. They compelled the Levant consul to take to underhand practices by giving him the pay of a clerk whilst directing him to take the position of a magistrate. Therefore, the high expectations combined with the pitiful salary, the Times understood, was in fact precisely the reason which made a certain technology of people uniquely able to accept and in fact to retain postings in the Levant. A later inquiry in 1870 debated this point to some extent. It emerged that salaries were never enough to conduct diplomatic business properly and consuls were expected to invest into settling themselves in their new post. Leave to go back to England to visit family was limited only to 1 month including travel and resulted in the salary being cut in half. And this made the leave of absence unaffordable altogether. This was an additional element, it was made out, that made the Levant consul lose contacts with the English way and become more and more like the people amongst whom they lived. In 1871, George Jackson Eldridge from Syria testified that the government inquired that the government failed to pay staff enough to enable them to live decently. Men could hardly be expected to expatriate themselves out of poor patriotism, and certainly could not travel with the consular salary. Biotti, Kumberbach and others suggested that the cumulative period of three years without deduction of salary might help in this. The 1870 inquiry, therefore, perfectly pictures the reason that made the Levant consular service continue to rely on the very personnel that the press and the inquiries in Parliament continue to criticize. The limited salary, the complicated political circumstances, the necessity to understand the language and meet local costumes made the newly appointed officials coming directly from England completely inadequate, if not a liability. Although both the Times and the committee pointed out the necessity of moving from their post regularly, because business and family ties could get in the way of conducting the job impartially, it was understood at this point that non-religious global custom could only come as a result of a long residence. Therefore, within other areas of the world, regularly changing postcodes of benefit, in the Levant it constitutes a problem. A consul who had been many years in the post acquired broken knowledge and was therefore of immense value to the service. It was for this reason, both inquiries found, that these important posts were staffed with men who had lived and served most of their lives in Turkey. So my research stops with the 1870 inquiry, but up to that year, the employment of the Levantines, far from having diminished, had in fact consolidated in the Levant service. And this was, there was another reason for this, because by this stage, they had become precious collaborators of the British government for a less publicized duty, the search of antiquities for the British Museum. Within the context of the European race to establish museums in the capital of Europe, consuls and diplomats in the Ottoman Empire gained an unparalleled position to source antiquities. Whether to top up their full salary or in the hope of a promotion, there is ample and ever-emerging documentation of their activities in the archives of the British Museum and the National Archives in Kew. Charles Thomas Newton had requested an appointment as Vice Consul Mitiline after a number of years working as an assistant at the BM. There he had observed the potential of a diplomatic appointment and through influential friends had managed to obtain one for himself in 1852. This appointment gave him authority and, although modest, a salary. His assistant's description of the locals is interesting and showed that mistrust and suspicion were mutual feeling between the new officials and the old establishment. In England, you can have no idea of the people we come in contact with here. Fortunately, we are three together and we depend on no one but ourselves for society. It is a curious feeling to know before people open their lips they will in all probability be about to tell you the truth. Yet, these feelings were dictated by a lack of understanding of local tradition and the impossibility of speaking the language, a condition that left both deeply unaware of people's real attitudes. Ignorance toward the importance of antiquities and heritage for the modern Greeks made them assume that the furnishing of the National Museum in England a priority over local rights and feelings. But were the Greeks really not able to understand such significance? The evidence and the accounts confirm that, on the contrary, they were perfectly aware of the importance of antiquities for the Greeks. Newton himself writes, having found a piece of marble that he wanted to remove from a field, that on turning up in the field, he found all manners of dormant opposition. First, the dear Pishaga of the district, my next opponent was the proprietor of the field, the lady of the manor, who denied the right of anyone to remove it. I found her already in possession of the field of battle, seated on the stone itself, in the apse of a roofless chapel. At the sight of Aristobulus Sacrilegius Pater, she became animated with the fury of an ancient fighter. She bowed down to the ground at least 12 times, kissing it and crossing itself each time, and then she lit a fire and burnt incense to purify the place from our presence, and with great horror flung out the secret of the sacred presence some chicken bones, the remain of our yesterday luncheon. I saw from the first that she was utterly beyond the reach of persuasion, and in my despair, having exhausted my little stock of Greek, I came to speak English to her, a sure way to aggravate an angry native in the Levant. So, Newton remained in the Aegean for 4 years, but in that brief time, he found in the Levantine consuls, vice consuls, and consular agents there the most valued collaborators for research of antiquities. When in 1859 the British Museum sought to appoint an agent for excavating Rhodes, Newton wrote to the then principal librarian and his friend Panizzi, "This is a mistake. No ostensible agent of the British government should be sent to the Levant to purchase antiquities. By employing consuls as agents, a much more effectual agency is set on foot. No one can compete with a consul in the market except another consul. His dragoman is in much the same position as a solicitor of a small country town in England. He knows everybody's secrets, doubts, and crimes. Here, money will not purchase much in the Levant, but money and consular influence together will do much. I've traveled much for 6 years, so the real prizes were not sold to the agent of the British Museum, but to the vice consul of Mitilini and the acting consul of Rhodes. Mr. Pullum, the proposed agent, would find when he came to purchase that he required that particular influence that no one but the consul's struggling can bring into play. Therefore, he continued that all he could possibly do for the museum could be a great deal better done by the present vice consul of Rhodes, Mr. Pigliotti. who has the most extensive connection in the islands and whom I find very well disposed to help me because he's an unpaid vice consul and living in the hopes of getting something from the government. Should the government insist, they would find that the French would bring their own agent, and this would be a problem. So, Newton pointed out to Panizzi how Bigliotti, who was looking for a paid consular appointment, would be the perfect agent instead. Appointing him as a paid consul would be a fair exchange for excavating antiquities. In fact, Bigliotti was already doing so in the Aegean, and Newton, this is one of his pieces at the end, and Newton wrote on this point that he saw that his collection was so important that he had purchased one of the pieces. And he said, this guy is so, he wants to be liberal because he's our unpaid vice consul, I wrote, and wants advancement in the service. The consequent career of Alfred Bigliotti as a result of his appointment as British official and the special task of excavating antiquities for the British Museum has been described by David Bartlett. The antiquities procured by Charles Manning are described by Yannis Galanakis, who, taking up from where I left, tells also how Newton organized the local consuls in a group to collect antiquities. And he explains, for the benefit of the museum, and he writes that Manning's special interest in the subject was also supported by the realization that for a consul placed in Imperius and paid an ordinary salary, antiquities provided an opportunity to make a small profit. The interaction with his colleagues eventually changed Colnaghi's view of the Levantines. In a later end in his diary we read, I'll shorten it up, Mr. Howe, an Englishman by name and nature, born in Cyprus, where he has lived all his life. His father died while he was a child. His mother was Greek, so he cannot speak English. And yet, such is the force of blood, his thoughts and sympathies are those of a true Briton. He's well acquainted with the island, and under rather a rough exterior, proved himself to be a good companion and a very useful in search of antiquities. The search of antiquities was an aspect of the consular duties that did not enter into the official government inquiries onto the consular service, at least until 1870. It, however, became one further and important element that allowed to justify and, in fact, to promote the appointment of Levantine's personnel by the Foreign Office. And it is for this reason that their use within the service was never really shelved. One last quotation. Do you think, in the parliamentary inquiries, do you think that the commercial interests of this country have suffered from the inferiority of our consuls in the East? I did not admit that there was inferiority in our consuls in the East. We have some extremely able men, and we have naturally some people who are not such as we should like to have. But generally speaking, they are efficient men, and some of the very best are what is generally called Levantines. Many thanks.
Thank you. Do we have any questions? Yes, please. You can address them. But do we have a microphone that we have for that?
Is that a microphone?
Yes, it's coming over. It's coming
over. My question is for Mr. Umberto. He mentioned various names, which we still have in Greece, Negroponte, or Della Grammatica. Equally, we have in Greece, in Syros, half the population is Catholic. The same applies to one or two other islands, but not so in Crete. Can he tell us the reason for these names still existing in Greece, and these islands having these Catholic minorities?
Well, thank you for your questions. Well, actually, for the first one, I don't know. I want to know more about these families. So what I can tell you is that Well, I just found them not only in the Venetian archives, I found them also in the propaganda feed in Rome, and you can find them also in the French and Dutch archives. So they were trying to strengthen their position because they were Catholic, and actually in this period being Orthodox in the Ottoman Empire was better than being Catholic. So they were trying a protection from the European states. But I don't know if I answered, but for the first one, for the first question, I don't really know. I'm sorry, but thank you for your interest.
We have a question here. By the way, isn't it great to have an academic answer a question partially by saying, I don't know? I think that's a great sign of an academic career. I do that often myself.
Well, thank you. First, I want to thank all four speakers for a fantastic presentation. I learned so much. I would have a question to Dr. Signori. In what you said and what you showed on the screen, I remember there was a document which ascertained that the diplomatic office holder was still liable to paying the poll tax to the Ottoman government. And then later on you spoke of all sorts of advantages that came with taking on such an office. So I was wondering, were the representatives taking on such an offer, were they generally exempt from paying the poll tax, or would that continue, or were they just a mixed picture?
Thank you for this question. Well, actually, it was more complex than this, because all Venetian subjects in the Ottoman Empire were exempted by the poll tax. But, they were Ottoman subjects, so their families usually paid this poll tax. They wanted to be recognized as foreigners in order to avoid the risks that their local lavery can took to them. So, actually, they tried to be accepted from this poll tax. Usually they realize this with success, these ambitions, but not always. So we have a lot of firmans, so Sultan decree that states that Venetian consuls, they don't have to pay this poll tax. But actually it was more an unlocal thing. So it was repeatedly negotiated at this time.
Any questions? No. Okay, I believe then this marks the end of our first panel. Thank you to our panelists and everyone here. We will have a lunch break and then we'll be back.